cuta wuta ta gani ta kukan ma. Are depressing. Over 70. And I'm sorry to be blunt, but you know, you're going to hear this from me. Listen, hiding these statistics is not going to change reality. Perhaps some of you might be shocked. Oh my God, he's speaking like this in the masjid. Ya akhi, if I don't speak about it in the masjid, where else are you going to hear it? If you're not going to understand, I'm not going to understand that our children are living in this land and they're facing these problems and we don't solve them here, where else do you expect them to be solved? So I apologize from now. I'm still, you know, you don't know my habits that well, but I don't shy away from speaking that which is going to protect our community. Over 75% of teenagers in this land are engaging in intercourse. Teenagers, 75%, both genders. Stop deluding yourself that your children and your child is an angel. Stop deluding yourself. My child and your children are living in the same land. May Allah protect all of us. We need to be aware of this. I'm sorry to be so blunt. A colleague of mine did her PhD in a Canadian university in sociology. I know her. I read her summary of the PhD. I have it on my file. And the PhD was the drug and sexual habits of Muslims on college campuses. The most thorough survey done of our Muslim community. And I'm not going to give you the numbers because honestly, I thought I knew, but reading that, it was like a dagger to my heart. We have an endemic crisis. I'm not going to give you the numbers. Suffice to say, it is terrifying. Terrifying. She did an anonymous survey, the most thorough survey of college going Muslim boys and Muslim girls. Drug use, tobacco use, alcohol, and zina. And the surveys are there. It's a public PhD. You can even find it if you want to look at it. It's there. The findings are there. This is the world we live in. Now my point is, this could never have been predicted even 100 years ago. Even 100 years ago. No one could have predicted this type of revolution. Because these families, the same people that were living amongst, they had haya as well. I mean, if you watch Little House on the Prairie, they're wearing hijab better than some of us wear hijab. That's the reality. They had strict laws. Men and women are not going to be together, you know, in public. They're not going to go out on a date unless it is meant for marriage purposes. There's no such thing as casual dating. All of this has changed. And our Prophet ﷺ predicted what? He predicted intisharu zina. Zina would be everywhere. And he also predicted that nudity would be everywhere. Fahisha would be everywhere. That people would show their bodies in public. And again, I don't need to comment to you. I just want to mention once again, these are things we don't understand and know. But in this country, in our own generation, the issues of pornography have changed radically. In the 60s even, it was technically illegal to get pornography. In the 60s. And the famous, you know, Hustler magazine guy went to the Supreme Court and overturned the ruling. And in one generation, from it being illegal to get a magazine, now pornography is ruining every household in this land. And we still are reeling from the damages because of the internet and whatnot. Who could have predicted this? Who could have predicted this? One generation ago, the government, our government, had a special body to monitor Hollywood. And any scene that was deemed to be immoral was cut off. This is Hollywood. And that is why you will not find nudity in black and white movies. Why? Because our own government had some haya. And they would monitor Hollywood movies. Subhanallah, in the 30s and 40s, if it showed drug use or extramarital affairs, the movie would have to show that the people who did it suffered, because they wanted to teach morality. They wanted to demonstrate that drug users don't end up happy. They wanted to demonstrate extramarital affairs, they have problems. This is in this land. That's why if you look at the 40s and 50s, Clark Gable, all of these famous people, you look at their movies, overall there's a positive image. Not that negative. Nowadays, a'udhu billah, even Disney Channel, you have to say, astaghfirullah, tawbah, tawbah, when you watch Disney Channel, right? When I grew up, Disney Channel was relatively innocent, back in the 80s and whatnot. Relatively innocent, okay? We grew up in a different era. Now, Disney Channel itself, every second joke is a sexual innuendo. Every second thing is about boyfriend, girlfriend, and then these days boyfriend as well. Who could have predicted this in one generation? Our Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam predicted it. He predicted it in an era and a time place where no one could have imagined that nudity would be prevalent. And he said that this is going to be the norm. So much so, and the hadith is explicit, and this hadith is authentic, that a time will come when copulation will occur in public, like donkeys do. In public. And wallahi, I think we are even less than one generation. Wallahu musta'an. The way things are headed now, Allah protect us. And there will be a man who will see this happening, and he will say to them, couldn't you get a room? Couldn't you go behind a door or a wall? And that man, the Prophet ﷺ said, will be deemed by them to be so righteous the way you look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Look at this. And if you look at where this society is heading, I swear to you, it is terrifying. Anyone above the age of 35, you see how quickly, you teenagers, you youngsters, for you this seems to be the norm. We who have grown up in the 70s and 80s, we will tell you how quickly things have changed in our own lifetimes. From where to where? And what's going to happen in one generation? It's exponentially changing. It's not changing, you know, steadily. No, it's exponentially changing. And frankly, that also explains the rise of weird manifestations of sexual habits as well, which we're seeing as well, because this is what happens when you open the door. Who predicted this? Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He mentioned that towards the end of times, there will be a lot of women who, they are clothed and yet they are naked. Kasiyatun ariyat. Hadith is in Bukhari. In other words, they're not dressed properly. And ma'ilatun mumilat. They will love to entice others, and others will love to be enticed by them. In other words, what this means, flirtation is open, and sexuality is open. Our elders here don't know what Tinder is. This is what Tinder is, exactly what it is. They want to do one way, and the other one wants to do back to them. This is now open without even haya. Haya itself has gone. And this is explicitly predicted by the Prophet ﷺ, that of the last things to be gone from mankind will be haya. When haya is gone, wait for judgment day. And we see this as well. Of the things predicted as well is the proliferation of intoxications towards the end of times, and the proliferation of music as well. Now, music existed in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. I mean, it existed, but it wasn't common. It wasn't the norm. Intoxicants existed, of course, but again, it wasn't the norm. And our Prophet ﷺ came and forbade intoxication and definitely discouraged the issue of musical instruments. And he predicted that a time will come when this will be the norm. It will be everywhere. And again, we see this now, that the rise of, you know, marijuana and other things is now the norm, common. It is something that, unfortunately, even our own youngsters, many of them don't think this to be a big deal as well. Of the trends that are predicted by our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the building of magnificent masjids that will be empty. We seek Allah's refuge from ever having magnificent masjids that are empty. It's good to have good masjids, but we want them to be packed. But he predicted that a time will come when the masjid will be magnificent and nobody will come to pray in them. We seek Allah's refuge, but there are plenty of masajid. Millions, multi-millions. And I don't want to mention too explicit, but especially in those oil rich countries, you see in the middle of nowhere, just for the sake of showing that I built it, and so much, hundreds of millions is spent. And when you come to salah, it is empty, completely empty. That's not the goal of the Sharia. Now, again, you're coming to the masjid, we want the masjid to be beautiful, alhamdulillah. The problem is not in beautifying the masjid, the problem is in building the masjid for the sake of the building and not for the sake of the people. When the masjid is empty, that is a problem. And our Prophet ﷺ predicted that there will come a time when Zakhrafat al-Masajid, the masjid will be beautiful, but the people will not be there to pray. And that is the exact opposite of the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The masjid was very, very simple. So much so, perhaps if one of us went there, we would wrinkle our nose and we'd have to put our hands and clothes like this, like there was no carpet. There was no carpet. The masjid had pebbles. And that's why the Sahaba would not take their shoes off when they entered. They would pray with their shoes in that masjid, by the way. Because you were praying on the sand, on the rubble. You're praying on the pebbles. There is no carpet. So the Sahaba would pray with their shoes on. And there was no roof. And one time it rained, everybody became soaking wet. And so some leaves were put for a temporary period of time. In the whole lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ, there was not a solid roof. Do you know that? In the whole lifetime, this happened in the reign of Umar ibn al-Khattab. He decided to make some solid thatched roof. Otherwise, in the whole lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ, there was no solid roof. Eventually, they put a interlocking leaves to protect them from the sun, but not from the rain. And that is why even one of the final Ramadans of our Prophet ﷺ's life, it rained heavily and the masjid became muddy. And Anas ibn Malik said, "Fawallahi, I swear, I saw the Prophet ﷺ lower his head into the mud in the 27th to 23rd night. It was predicted to be Laylatul Qadr. And he raised his head up and the mud was on his forehead. He was not embarrassed or shy to put his head down for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one is honored more than the one who lowers his head to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The point being, the Prophet ﷺ predicted this issue of beautifying the masajid while neglecting the people in the masjid. And Anas ibn Malik commented on this hadith, the hadith of the masjid, and he said, a time will come when people will boast about the masjid, but they won't visit it. They will boast about how beautiful the masjid is, but they will not be inside praying. We seek Allah's refuge, and inshallah our masjid is not like that, but let us be honest, there are masajid around the globe that people do boast about their masjid, but the boast that how big it is, how beautiful it is, and not the quality of the people in it. Of the generic trends that are mentioned, and this is one of those trends that again, very cryptic, the famous hadith in the hadith of Jibreel, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that of the signs of Judgment Day is that the slave girl shall give birth to her own master. This is one of the most famous cryptic predictions of Judgment Day. What does it mean that a slave girl will give birth to her own master? This is one of those things, again, like I said, there are a lot of different opinions about what this implies. One opinion is that Islam will spread so quickly that people will lose track of who is a slave and who belongs to whom, such that the children will then assume that their own mother is their slave. And this is therefore, what is the prediction? The prediction is the quick conquest of Islam. The prediction is how quickly Islam will spread. That is one interpretation. Another interpretation, which is the one of Hafidh ibn Hajar, is that children will become dominant over their parents. I'll be quiet here and let that sink in amongst the parents, especially those parents who have teenagers, and take some consolation that this is predicted and Ibn Hajar has predicted it. Children will become bossy and domineering over the parents. Who is in charge? If you go to some households, you don't quite know who is actually in charge of what is going on. And in fact, this was commented on by Ibn Hajar 800 years ago, that the meaning of this hadith is that the children will dominate and give the orders and be disrespectful to their parents. So they will be the ones calling the shots and the parents will be then, being in charge. So this is another interpretation as well, that the children will be disrespectful and the children will be bossy over their parents. These are the two main interpretations of this hadith.
The video was about, I don't know about you guys, I mean there's so much to learn from these predictions which have obviously come true, even the over sexualization of things in, rather just the sexualization of stuff in everything we watch, the movies we watch, even what our, I don't have children, but what children are watching out there, even on Disney, we really have to see these things. Otherwise, let me know what you think. Make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe.